I'm Alan Toll. I'm a professor of medicine at Columbia University, and I'm a distinguished lecturer on behalf of the ATVB Council at the annual spring meeting in Toronto. And I'd like to talk a little bit about the lecture that I'm going to give. So it's long been known that the numbers of white cells and platelets in the blood are predictive of the process of atherosclerosis and thrombosis. And so there are many studies in humans showing that the level of the blood leukocytes or white cells, as well as the level of blood platelets, have a predictive relationship to atherosclerotic disease and thrombosis. And so when the levels of those cells are high in the blood, you're more likely to get an atherothrombotic event, that is a heart attack or stroke. So we've been using mouse models to try to understand the underlying causes of those relationships. And we discovered a few years ago that in mouse models where there are defects in cholesterol metabolism, that results in an increased activity of stem cells in the bone marrow, so-called hematopoietic stem cells, that lead to the bone marrow to churn out higher numbers of white cells, inflammatory cells. And more recently, we actually also linked overactivity of the so-called progenitor cells. They're the cells that are a little later down the line than the stem cells, but this progenitor cells that give rise to megakaryocytes, that in turn give rise to blood platelets, that their activity is also increased when there are defects in cholesterol metabolism in the body or on a cellular level. And so the specific, my talk will go into the specific molecular perturbations that lead to those processes and the underlying mechanisms. I'm going to focus on cellular pumps, ABC binding cassette transporters that are known to act in a way that promotes the efflux of cholesterol from cells. And so the first ones of those that were discovered were ABCA1 and ABCG1. And it was known for some time that they act in macrophages to promote cholesterol efflux from the macrophages onto components of HDL. And in that way, would inhibit the formation of macrophage foam cells in atherosclerotic lesions. So the work of many different scientists has contributed to those findings and ideas. And we discovered somewhat serendipitously in a mouse model where two of those transporters were knocked out, ABCA1 and ABCG1, that there are very high blood levels of monocytes and neutrophils. And when we traced this back into the bone marrow, we discovered that the transporters were also highly expressed in hematopoietic stem cells. And when they were knocked out, those cells accumulated cholesterol, and they became more responsive to growth factors that normally promote the proliferation of stem cells. And this then resulted in more myelopoiesis, that's the formation of white cells, and higher blood levels of monocytes and neutrophils, which then go on to enter atherosclerotic plaques and promote the process of atherosclerotic plaque formation. More recently, we chased down another ABC transporter, a close relative of ABCG1 called ABCG4. And this was a bit of a mystery because we actually did an experiment where we looked at the effect of deficiency of ABCG4 in blood-forming cells on atherosclerosis and found that atherosclerosis was increased. But when we looked in the atherosclerotic plaque, we found that ABCG4 was not expressed. And so then, of course, based on the earlier work with the other transporters, we went back again and traced it back into the bone and the bone marrow. And in this case, it wasn't the actual stem cells, but a cell that's further down the line towards the progenitor cell for platelets called a megakaryocyte progenitor cell. And in that case, ABCG4 was highly expressed in the megakaryocyte progenitor cells, and it was promoting cholesterol efflux onto an HDL particle. And this served to in the normal mouse to limit excessive proliferation of these cells. So when that transporter was knocked out or defective, megakaryocyte progenitors overproliferated. There were more megakaryocytes in the blood, and that resulted in a higher level of platelet counts. And those mice were susceptible to more atherosclerosis and also to more thrombosis in a model where you injure the carotid artery with a standard method and then look at the rate of thrombus formation. That these mice form the thrombus more readily. So that will be the main part of the talk and discussion. I'm going to talk a little bit about the detailed molecular cellular mechanisms by which a cell, when it has a defect in cholesterol efflux, it builds up cholesterol in the membrane, and then this inactivates what's called a negative feedback loop, which normally regulates the level on the cell surface of the growth factor receptor. So normally, when a growth factor binds its receptor, it then results in a downregulation of the receptor, so-called negative feedback. And that stops the cell from proliferating excessively. But when the level of cholesterol builds up in the membrane, that negative feedback loop fails. And so there's excessive and ongoing stimulation of growth and proliferation. So this is a concept that sort of connects cholesterol with excessive cell proliferation, which is relevant to atherosclerosis, as I've said, but also may be relevant to the process of cancer as well. In the final part of my talk, I'm going to discuss some recent human genetic evidence that suggests that the same pathways that we've identified in mouse studies may also be active in humans and be responsible in part for some of the recent findings in human genome-wide association studies that associate mutations or variants in specific genes with atherosclerosis or thrombosis. So some of those so-called single nucleotide polymorphisms in human genome-wide association studies may in fact be working and operating through the same pathways that we have defined in mice. And so it's my belief that there may be new therapeutic opportunities in this area. People with high levels of neutrophils and monocytes in their blood, as I said, are at increased risk of atherosclerotic disease. And it's been speculated by others previously that limiting the overproduction of those cells might be a new way of therapy. Of course, there's been a lot done in that area in the cancer field, but our studies point to new ways, new molecular targets, if you like, that could allow limitation of overproduction of white cells and platelets that could eventually be a treatment for human atherosclerosis, that is, heart attack and stroke. In this work, Nan Wang, my colleague, has been a major contributor, Carrie Welch as well, and a postdoc, Wei Wang. I'll be presenting some of her work, and I'm indebted to my colleagues and collaborators for enabling me to give this talk today. Okay. Thank you.